you'll be talking.
And then the only words that come out are just foie gras. Foie gras.
Welcome to Common Ground Discourse. We are your co-hosts. God's peace. I'm Brother Kenneth.
And I'm Shane Swore. This is episode 4 of the program. Today, Kenneth will be speaking on Kohlberg's stages of moral development. First, we want to thank you again for tuning in. If this is your first time, we hope that you enjoy what we have to offer. And if this is a continuing occurrence for you, participating in our audience, again, thank you so much. As you've noticed, we've already started to offer some responses to those who have engaged either in comments or in our personal lives asking us questions. We've been offering responses. So again, thanks so much. So today, this is going to be another episode that we will be adding to our academic topic list. And we hope that this is a nice refresher course for those of you who have studied this either in philosophy classes or in psychology classes or ethics. If this is your first time, it should be a fairly thorough introduction into what Kohlberg did in his work. But before we get started, I really want to ask, how does Kohlberg's work tie into Fowler's? Or what did Fowler build off of this? How are they connected? And where does that connection stop?
Yeah, it's a good question. As you know, we spent so much time going over Fowler's stages of development. And so much of what he has is due entirely to Kohlberg. His whole six-stage theory is based off of Kohlberg's six-stage theory, going from a more egotistical view to a universal view. He even starts to borrow some of that language. His concept of the stage theory, which Kohlberg himself got from Piaget, is intrinsic in that you can't jump stages, that they have to go in a particular order because each one is developed off of the other. So the model of stage theory and then the breakdown of those stages in their development, moving from the personal egotistic or egocentric view and then moving outwards to a more universal view, is the same pattern that Fowler then adopted. Essentially, he took Kohlberg's stages and applied religious language to it.
Excellent. Great. Well, without further preamble, we'll turn it over to Kenneth.
As Shane said, today we're going to go over Kohlberg's stages of morality. Similar to what we covered with Fowler, I'll go through the early stages, what led to Kohlberg's work, because obviously this foundation material that he had to work with, and then go into the stages of Kohlberg. Then I will conclude with an overview of some of the dilemmas that he would use. These dilemmas, a situation in which there is no full positive outcome, there is no outcome without a consequence, is how he would judge people according to their moral thinking. So, back to the beginning, his foundations. Kohlberg's work is based off primarily Piaget. Piaget was studying cognitive development, very specifically with early childhood going into adolescence. What Piaget was studying is that as the brain physically develops, as the neurological processes develop with the biological growth of the brain from infancy into adulthood, the thinking will change. If the brain changes, obviously parts of the thinking can change depending on where you're thinking in the brain. So what he was showing is that for a very clear set of ages, you would think a different way. And from this, from early childhood into adolescence, mapping that with a large population, you'd be able to see where there are deviations. Some of the things that he pointed out were spatial thinking and logic. For instance, at a certain young age, if you take two same size vials of water, and then you pour the water into another that is taller but thinner and ask the child now which one has more, they will point to the one that is wider. Then, having seen both that they were the same volume, then do it a year or so later and they'll be able to see or say that they are the same in volume because they saw perfectly that they were the same volume to start. Just because you poured it into a new one doesn't mean it's changed volume. So their perception of the world changes, and you're able to see healthy development based on those ages and their perceptions. This stage development, like all stage theory, has to go in order. You cannot jump stages with stage theory because each one is based off the development of the prior stage. Also, for Kohlberg, less than with Fowler, as we noticed, his is more fluid. But with Kohlberg, he followed the strict stage theory that you are progressional. You do not regress. Obviously, with cognitive development, if the brain is moving forward, you're not going to learn to see equal volumes and then regress back into a stage that was less developed in the brain. Similar to Kohlberg, if you've reached a level of morality, you're not going to regress into a lower level of morality. That was later challenged, as we see in spiral dynamics, but for Kohlberg, we have to understand that was one of his principles. So that's where he picked up his cognitive development, that's where he picked up his stage theory primarily, and that's what's going to set the groundwork for Kohlberg's stages of morality. Kohlberg's premise in this, before we get into the stages, his premise was that you should be able to have a morality, be able to look at the moral thinking of people, regardless of culture, regardless of nationality, and be able to see, just like cognitive development, a universal progression. You should be able to see major milestones, identifiers for that progression that show up in every human being. His stages of morality were free of religious thought, free of faith language. He felt that moral thinking itself was a human condition, and that moral thinking would always progress the same way with a certain person. Again, there's pushback to this later on because of the dependence on culture, how culture forms and defines who we are. Not just culture, but also our subculture. Carol Gilligan, that I'll cover, she pushed back because she offered a feminist approach to Kohlberg, or a feminist critique, rather, to Kohlberg's stages of morality. But Kohlberg believed that there was a universal progression of moral thinking. And let me stress that. This is moral thinking. For Kohlberg, it's not the moral decision. It's not the act at the end that defines morality. It is how you think about that act, what your intention is, what led to your decision to do that. Because of this, because of him looking at moral thinking, not moral action, you wind up with people at stage 4, stage 5, stage 6, theoretically, that can be at disparate ends of a spectrum. You can have, for instance, in the if you're looking at Planned Parenthood, you can have someone that is pro-choice and pro-life, both at stage 5 thinking. It's not the decision that they make, it's how they make the decision. And that's what he was going for. What is the thought process that leads to your action? How do you relate to others? How do you relate to the world around you? How do you relate to yourself, your place in that world? All of that together to make your decision is your moral thinking, not the moral action. So when we look at stages of morality and moral development, you cannot look at the actions of a society. You have to look at, or the individual, you have to look at what led to that. That's why he had the dilemma test, in order to hear a subject's thinking process. Describe why they chose this, not that they chose this. So with that as our parameters, let's go into the stages of Kohlberg. Just as we said with Fowler, who based his off Kohlberg, there are 6 stages. With these 6 stages, Kohlberg himself broke them up into 3 major groups. You have pre-conventional, that's stages 1 and 2, conventional, 3 and 4, post-conventional, stages 5 and 6. We don't necessarily need to go into great depth of what the definitions of pre-conventional, conventional, and post-conventional are. The descriptors of the stages themselves will be enough to give us a roadmap. So we start with stage 1. Stage 1 is obedience and punishment. If you look at an action and it leads to a punishment, that is the qualifying factor for someone doing or not doing something. As you would expect, since this is based off Piaget's cognitive development, stage 1 is attributed to the very young. If you're looking at toddlers, if you're looking at very, very young children, why do you not do something? Because I will get in trouble for it. Because I will be punished. I won't get the cookie, I will be spanked. Whatever the punishment is, that is what will qualify something being necessarily right or wrong. It doesn't matter, it doesn't talk about what the impact has on other people. It doesn't talk about the impact or the desire to receive something. It's strictly based on, am I receiving punishment or reward for this? So that's stage one, obedience and punishment. If you look at stage two, this is where you move from the punishment area, the outside force that defines us, now going to a more egocentric. Both of these are based off a more egocentric view. Am I being punished? That's stage one. And now, am I really getting what I want? That's stage two. Stage two, the self-interest. The only time you really see it affecting my work versus someone else, letting someone else do something that's not necessarily what I want, is when you see a reciprocal action. I scratch your back if you scratch mine. Because at the end of that decision, it has to be about me. That's stage two. Can I get this? Whether or not you follow a rule, the question is, will I get what I want in the end and get away with it? You begin to see some echoes of stage one going into stage two. As always with stage theory, there's a remnant of the stage that will transfer over until they're fully out of it. But the focus of stage one is punishment. The focus of stage two, self-interest. Do I get what I want? They may say I'm not allowed to have a cookie, but I want the cookie, so I'm going to get said cookie. Now, if my self-interest in getting that cookie is outweighed by a lack of desire or I don't get what I want later on because I got what I want here, it's still based around what I want. And that's the justifying means between the two. Both of those are pre-conventional. It's more egocentric. Then we go into the second of his stages or his groupings, the conventional. This is stage three and now stage four. If stage two is about self-interest, stage three is the interpersonal account. This is where I look between myself and another, and am I in accord? Am I conforming to this other? We've moved out of the egocentrics to strictly what I want, now starting to take into consideration something bigger than my own identity. Whether this is the family group, whether this is a societal group, a larger family, community, neighborhood, whatever, we begin to see the expansion of the self-identity. So in stage three, it's how do I fit with others? More importantly, how do others see me? It's not necessarily the punishment that we see in stage one, how they affect me with that punishment. It's more, how am I seen by them? How am I in their eyes? How do they look at me? Do they praise me or do they denigrate me? We see language of good and bad. Am I a good boy? Am I a bad boy? Bad girl, good girl. Am I considered good by these people? That is what starts to move and motivate decisions at this point. Not do I get what I want, but will people think good of me because I did this action? It's not I did this because I feel good about myself doing it. Stage three is strictly, do my parents think I'm a good boy because I've done this? Does my teacher think I'm a good student because I have done my homework? All of these are stage three thinking in which you are reflected back by the people outside of you. We move from stage three then into stage four, and this is where Kohlberg said most adults will stop. Again, just like stage three, it's dependent on the outside forces. But rather than being considered good or bad, their perspective of am I a good or bad person, you are now in bounds of the law that is outside of you. Stage four is this authority and social order maintenance. Do I respect the authority? Has the authority told me to do this? If the authority, whoever that authority is, if the authority has told me to do this, then I have to do it. The primary focus of decisions in stage four is, will social order be maintained? Will the civility, will the accord, will the stability of my community maintain because I follow these rules? Not am I a good boy. I can be considered a good or bad boy, but the thought is, will the social order around me now be maintained? You often hear in this the kind of thinking of, if I break this law, then what's to stop this person from breaking that law? And if that person breaks that law, then that person, and then all social order will fall apart. You hear that domino effect because the primary concern is social order. Are we in our place? Can society function? It admits that there is a conflict between personal need and social maintenance. And in that conflict, in that dissonance, then it always gives over to the maintenance of law, the maintenance of a social order. If you watched our episode on Fowler's Stages of Faith, you begin to hear an echo of stage three for Fowler. For stage three, his was the institutional identity. Stage four is when you start questioning that. But within Kohlberg, that's the social order of stage four. The questioning and the dissonance outside of a singular societal view doesn't happen until stage five. So if we're talking about social order, why do we obey laws? Because laws help us keep a peaceful society. That is stage four thinking. And again, that's where Kohlberg felt that most people stay. Most adults plateau. That's our conventional stages. Then we move into the final category, the post-conventional, which picks up our final two stages, stage five and stage six. If stage four is dealing with authority, and then how that deals with me, has the authority told me what is right or wrong, and I bow to that authority, stage five starts moving into a social conscience. It's not just what the authority has said, and I have to do what the authority is because I'm under the guise of that authority, or the guise of that authority. Stage five is a social contract. I am in this society, and I have chosen to be in this society. Stage four makes no decision of choice. You're automatically in it, and you have to maintain it. Stage five says, I am in the society, and I have a choice to participate in this society. And in order for this society to continue, I am in a contract that says, I will maintain the society, but also, this society has a side of the contract that is owed to me. That my personal rights, that my own success and happiness, my liberty, has to be honored by this society. Because we are in a contract, there is a responsibility from both ends. We also see at the social contract stage of stage five that each culture, each community, each nation, each subgroup or group may have different contracts. The laws of the United States may not be the same laws of France, Germany, Saudi Arabia, Nigeria. But because each one has its own social contract, they are distinct, and though they are different, they are not deficient. Each one has its own responsibility and has its own benefit. It is not responsible for someone in stage five to say, well, this is the law that I appreciate, the social contract that I am in, and I should now enforce this in a culture outside of my own. They recognize the difference, the distinction, and the autonomy of these diverse social contracts. Stage five starts to see that I may have a right that supersedes a law. That if the social contract I feel I am in is broken by the authority, then I have a right to rise up and contest that authority. You would never see that in stage four, because for stage four, the society defined by that authority has to be maintained. But in stage five, the individual finally comes out. The authority and autonomy, the rights of the individual, can now come out and contest that authority. For stage six, if stage five is the beginning of that individual, stage six makes those rights universal. If you have any language of universal human rights, anything that is universal to all people, regardless of culture, that we all have a right to life, we all have a right to respect. All of these universal rights are the language of stage six. Now, unlike Fowler, who was very distinct in his stage six, and as we contested, we really don't have any in real life that are stage six yet. For Kohlberg, stage six, because it starts opening up that door of universal rights, we see more people that venture into that stage. As I said, if you have anything about the universal right to life, that is the language of stage six. Now, the question, we start to see a slight deviation or slight blurring. If someone talks about the universal right to life, is that right to life something that was defined by the authority, or is it something that is universal to us because we are intrinsically human? That's where you have to start differentiating, just as when we looked at Fowler, stage 3 to stage 5. Stage 5 may use language of stage 3, but that's because stage 5 reappropriated that language. Similarly with Kohlberg, when distinguishing between the stages, while the reasoning, something that is universal, may be applied, we have to ask ourselves, where does that right come from? If you're in stage 6, it's intrinsic because we're human. If you're in stage 4 or even stage 3, it's because society has said everyone should have it. If you say you have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, a very obvious cliche within our own U.S. nation, if we look at that, a stage 6 person would say we have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness because every human has a right by the nature of their birth and their existence. If, however, someone says you have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness within our nation because it's protected by the Bill of Rights, then you have regressed to stage 4 and stage 3. So you begin to see the distinction. Just because they say everyone should have it, we have to ask ourselves, where does that qualifier come from? So those are the preliminary or the basics of the six stages. You have one, when you're looking at obedience and punishment. Do I do it because I'm going to get in trouble? Stage 2, we look at self-interest. Do I do it because I get something that I want? Stage 3, we're looking at, am I a good boy or am I a bad boy? We're looking at the reflection of the authority onto us, out of the egocentric into a more communal idea, a larger identity. Stage 4, do I do my action because the authority has told me it is right or wrong? Stage 5, do I recognize my own personal rights, and I have agreed that as long as my rights are protected by this society, then I will remain in conformity with said society. Stage 6, do I have rights that are not just intrinsic to me and my need, but universal to everyone, and I will protect those rights regardless of culture? So we see stages 1 through 6, and you begin to hear the language of reasoning that would lead to a decision. As I said at the beginning, it's not the action that defines, it's the reasoning that leads to. So you could have someone at stage 6 that choose, or have two people at stage 6 that choose opposite ends of a final action, but their reasoning, if they're both citing human rights, then that would lead to a stage 6 thinking or a stage 5 thinking. If you're looking at, for instance, pro-choice and pro-life. If you look at pro-choice, let's look at stage 6. If you are pro-choice, you believe that every woman, every individual has a right to their own body, their own maintenance, their own decisions and care for themselves because it is their body, their possession, their individual being. Every single person has it in the world, and it is not right for someone to infringe so personally onto that. It is a universal concept because every person has a right to their body. So we see and hear the universal language of stage 6 for a pro-choice person. Then we look at pro-life. Every single person has a right to life. If the life has begun, the life has an intrinsic value. Now, where they will begin to debate is to where that life actually is determined. But if they are citing the universal right to life, they're using stage 6 morality to do that. So as you see, two disparate ends for a decision, both using what would be considered higher moral thinking. I'll conclude with the means by which Kohlberg would test his various stages. How do you qualify someone 1 through 6? Well, you have to know their thinking. You have to hear their thinking. To do this, he posed a number of dilemmas. He came up with a dilemma, which is to say a situation in which there is no ultimate outcome that does not bear a negative consequence. Some of the popular dilemmas that most people hear about are the trolley dilemma, for instance, where you have a trolley going down a track, and if it stays on its current course, it will run into 10 people and kill them. You, however, happen to be sitting at a switch, and if it goes off onto another track, then it will kill only one person. The dilemma is this. If you stand at the switch and allow the train to move on as it is with no action on your part, not participating in the events that have already happened, then 10 people will die because you did nothing. But if you actively flip that switch, if you now participate and make a conscious decision to do something, in both you've made a decision, but in this you've now decided to actually act and take responsibility for the death of another by clicking the switch, then only one person dies while saving 10. Are you now morally culpable for the death, the active death of that one person, as opposed to the passive death of the 10? The reasoning that would lead to your decision is how Kohlberg would grade you from 1 to 6. Another is where you have a loved one who is dying of cancer, and you have a gentleman down the road who is a pharmacist and has come up with a drug that can miraculously now cure your loved one. The question is this. You do not have enough money to get this drug, and this is very simplified for the dilemma. You don't have enough money to get the drug. Do you now buy the or steal the drug because you can't buy it, or do you obey the laws and allow your loved one to die because laws have said you're not allowed to do it? Again, you can begin to hear the thinking that would go behind it. Well, if I steal it, then I'm considered a bad person. That's stage 3 thinking. If I steal it, it's because it's illegal. Stage 4 thinking. If I steal it, I might go to jail. That goes back to stage 1 thinking. In this, you begin to see that a person can be a mix of stages depending on their area of life. Now, Kohlberg felt that you moved ultimately from one stage into fully into the other. So he would take an average of this thinking and try to condense it down through all the dilemmas. But in spiral dynamics, which we've talked about in previous stage, you begin to see that in different aspects of your life, you might choose a different moral stage, a level of moral thinking, depending on where you are, whether you're talking about family or friends. To continue with the pharmacy dilemma, if the person that you have, that you love, you want to keep alive because you love them, and you want to have that person you love in your life, then that goes to self-interest. That's now stage 2 thinking. If, however, you want to keep them alive because everyone has a right to life, and a right to life is more important than a right to possession, ownership, material, wealth, whatever, then that is stage 6 thinking. So the same dilemma, but the reasoning is what would define your decision. Again, you either choose to steal it or not steal it, but both decisions can be ranked according to their stage. So that's the essence of Kohlberg's moral thinking. Again, it's universal for him, it's progressional, and it is without religion or faith as a definer. It's something intrinsic, he said, to every person. Once Kohlberg focused on this or published his work, there was a pushback against this. People began to find holes in it, one of which was his student, Carol Gilligan. Carol Gilligan looked at his work, looked at the people that, or his test subjects that were tested, and noticed that statistically, women were ranked lower, or scoring lower, than men. She looked at this and started looking at the language that was used. Because again, it's all about the language. How do you describe your decision? For Kohlberg, it's the individual choice. It's focused on the individual in its maintenance of authority. For Gilligan, she started to push back, saying that from a feminist perspective, women do not so much look at the individual in relationship to authority, but more in relationship to other people. So if you use the language of relationship, that would automatically score you lower on Kohlberg's dilemmas. To push back against this, she came up with her own scale of 3, which in essence then break down to 5, because you have a halfway point between 1 and 2 and 2 and 3. But suffice it to say, she had 3 main points. She used the same language as Kohlberg for his 3 main categories, pre-conventional, conventional, and post-conventional. But at that point, she deviates greatly from Kohlberg. Her language was that for feminists and women, or the womanist movement. For her, it was a language of relationship and what the woman is looking out for, either for herself or others. For the pre-conventional, for the earliest stage, she says this is based, similar to Kohlberg, on an individual need. It's more egocentric. What does the woman want for herself? If the woman, especially in pregnancy, for instance, is more concerned with her need, and this is from her own study, she found that with those she studied, pregnant women often scored in this area, that it's about matter of self-preservation. Now, granted, it's in relationship to the child that the mother is bearing, but the language she uses is self-preservation and the need for the self, I need this to be well. That's post, or rather pre-conventional, the first stage. Then you move into conventional, the middle stage. Gilligan says that at this point, women become more selfless. Women are looking at self-sacrifice. We begin to, if anyone has done any studies on gender biases and gender norms within America, or the West in general, you begin to see this language that women are subjugated, that they are taught that at this stage that a woman should give authority or give over their own rights, their own individual interests to those of others. Self-sacrifice, not just for others, but particularly for children, for their own progeny. The social norm of the woman in itself, sacrifice subservient to others. So that's stage two. Stage three, she said, is when the woman reclaims her agency and authority, not to the point that it's stage one, not that it's purely self-interest, but that the woman has discovered that she has intrinsic rights, she has intrinsic interests in relationship to others, and that while others have needs, because the needs of others are never considered in stage one, but now the woman can do what she wants for her interest, but it is still in relationship to the needs of others. How do they balance? Do my needs now outweigh the others? If there's a consideration of the needs of others, that's where Carol Gilligan says you're now at stage three. So you begin to see that stage three itself undergoes its evolution, undergoes its critique and feedback. And there are many others that have come up with now alternative theories. Kohlberg really broke the ground when he said, we can now document the progression of morality. Whether or not his is the ultimate decision still remains to be debated. Tons of people love Kohlberg and his work, and we still see a lot of validity in it. But just as Carol Gilligan showed, there are alternatives that can also show validity. And then we have others that have followed suit and come up with spiral dynamics and others in the more modern age. But what we are now going to venture into is in this progression. When we talk about a universal morality, is that applicable? When we talk about what is good or evil, right or wrong, is it the action or is it the intention that defines that? Having now discussed the basics of moral stage theory, we see that Kohlberg really laid the groundwork. He broke ground at this point. And people saw that there could be a progressional view of morality that wasn't necessarily dependent on faith, religion, or even culture. People began to push back against that. Obviously, Carol Gilligan showed an alternative, showing that you could have a feminist view. Others have now looked at further subgroups, not just feminist group, but a view, but a womanist group, LGBT view of morality. You then begin to see the beginnings of spiral dynamics. It's not strictly progressional, but it goes back and forth between these. That you can dip in and out depending on where you are in your life. All of this lays the groundwork for us to open up our discussion with our discourse. What is right or wrong? What is good or evil? How do we look at morality itself, moral decisions or the moral actions? What is it that defines good and evil for us, for an individual and in relationship to other people? For our further discussions, we're going to discuss the histories and philosophy, the histories and definitions of good and evil within theology. We're going to look at book studies such as Sam Harris's The Moral Landscape, where he says that there is a scientific grounds for defining morality. All of this gives us an understanding, or at least a framework, to see where are we in our thinking? Where are we in our actions? Can we actually define morality as a universal? These are the questions that we're going to wrestle with, and I invite you, if you have your own thoughts or comments on this already, to give those back to us either in email or in the comments section below. We can start to address those in our discussions and our further episodes and really open up the field. Within our own U.S. landscape right now, we have so much talk about what is right or wrong, the moral right, the religious right. Is this even language that is appropriate? Can we have a right or wrong that is not religious? We are in a point where this topic is most heated and most necessary for us to engage, and I hope you'll join us as we model how to engage that discourse in a civilized manner. How can we engage this openly and honestly without being defensive or offensive in our pursuit of this truth. If you like what you see, be sure to subscribe to our video, like us on Facebook, and we hope to see you next time. God's peace.